sadly say,
they have gone home.
Gone home.
They have gone home. They've joined the heavenly fold. They're walking the streets of pure gold. They left one by one as the work here was done.
Gone home.
Afternoon. We are here to celebrate the life of John Lee Davis. Most people refer to him as Johnny because just like the song said, he's gone home to be with the Lord. Unfortunately, I didn't get to know Brother Johnny as much as a lot of y'all did. It's quite apparent that he was very popular, very loved. If anyone was at the viewing last night, that was pretty obvious. There was cars parked a quarter mile down the road. You don't see that at a lot of funerals these days. He was very loved and very respected. I'm gonna read to you the obituary. Mr. John Lee Davis, 81, went home to be with the Lord Thursday evening. It was June the 1st, 2023, at the Hospice House Attila. He was born in Ware County to the late James Manning Bud Davis and Fanny Missouri Douglas Davis. He married the late Jeanette Wilson Davis in 1964. He retired from general housing where he worked as a production manager and attended Hesba Baptist Church. For those of you don't know, my name is Pastor Eric Buchanon. I'm the pastor of Hesba Baptist. Several of Brother Johnny's children are members of Hesba. And he came on several Sundays. Now, in addition to his parents and his wife, he's also preceded in death by six siblings: Levo Davis, Steedley, Floyd Davis, Wilmer Davis, Gihu Davis, Evelyn Davis Steverson, and Carrie Davis O'Berry. He is survived by a daughter, Nicole Sweat and Rob of Blackshear, two sons, John W. Davis and Manon Davis, and his wife Danielle, both of Blackshear, Georgia. He had four grandchildren: Logan, Karen, Lacey, Jameson Davis, Parker Mizell, and Rhett White, two great-grandchildren, Whit Karen and Illa Kate Karen, two sisters, Layla Jones of Brunswick, Georgia, and Judy Dean of White Oak, two brothers, Ronnie Davis of Waycross, and Reverend Clayton Davis of Millwood and numerous nieces and nephews and other relatives. Several weeks ago, when Brother Johnny started getting ill and was in the hospital, I made visits with him at the hospital. Now, I had spoken to Brother Johnny a little bit before in the past at church. And I got to speak with him in the hospital. Now, Brother Johnny had went to church years ago here, and then didn't go for years. And several people had asked him, said, "Brother Johnny, are you saved?" "Yeah, I'm saved. I'm going to heaven. I'm saved." But in the hospital, you know, Manning had asked me to talk to him about it. And Brother Johnny, I pulled up beside him and I asked him, I said, "Brother Johnny, I'm going to ask you something very personal. Is there a specific time in your life that you believed in the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ and confessed him as Lord and Savior?" And he got quiet for a minute. And then he said, Brother Manning was in here, his son was in a room with me. He says, "I want to go to heaven. I want to be saved." Spoke with him a little longer, prayed with him. And in that time, he confessed the Lord Jesus. And he believed in his heart that God raised him from the dead. And he repented. He returned. He turned from his sin. See, everyone in this room, including myself and Brother Clayton, were born sinners, all right? Because Adam and Eve, born into a perfect world, created out of the dust and breathed a soul into them by God, into a perfect world, they chose to sin against God. And because of that, we inherited that sin and we inherited that death. That death is physical death, which we are here today for. And then there is what's referred to as the second death, eternal death. Now, Brother Johnny was a very popular person, very loved. From what I understand, very kind, very loving, would go out of his way to do things for people. I have no doubt that there are people in this room that are the same way, that would literally give you the shirt off their back. But without Jesus, God says that those things, those deeds, are but filthy rags. In the right place, they're all in good. But without Jesus, when it comes to the things of heaven, when it comes to reuniting us with God, they're worthless. I'm going to share a little something from you from the book of John, chapter 11. Some of you probably know this story very well. Some of you, even if you're not in church that much, you're probably familiar with the name and the gist of the story. What I'm talking about today is about Jesus and Lazarus. Now, Jesus was out with his disciples doing what Jesus did, going from village to village, healing the sick, saving the lost. And he got some messengers from Mary Magdalene and her sister Martha, telling Jesus that their brother, Lazarus, was very, very sick and asking him to please come quickly. Well, Jesus, looking at his disciples, said, "We're going to wait two more days." But Jesus, he's very sick. actually he's sleeping. Well, some of the disciples said, well, if he's sleeping, he'll get better. And then Jesus told him plainly, he says, no, he's dead. He says, it's good that he died when I'm not there, because I want you to see what is going to happen. So he waited 2 days, and by the time he got there, Lazarus had been dead for 4 days, and he was in the tomb. Now, at that point, Martha come up to Jesus, and he said, Jesus said unto Martha, said, your brother shall rise again. And Martha said, I know he shall rise again in the resurrection at the last day. But Jesus said unto her, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. He said, do you believe this? And she said, yeah, Lord, I believe that thou art the Christ and the Son of God, which should come into this world. Now Jesus goes on to the tomb and he tells them to roll the stone away. And when he said that, the sister said, Jesus, but he stinks. He's been in there 4 days. As in South Georgia vernacular, he stinks bad. He stinks. There's going to be an odor. But Jesus told them to roll the stone away anyway, and he did. And he said, Lazarus, step forth. And guess what happened? Lazarus, all wrapped up like a mummy, came walking out of that door. You see, when Jesus gives a command, everything has to listen, including death. Jesus has power over death. Now, Jesus tells us that healthy mourning, a certain amount of mourning and grieving is healthy and is biblical. But Jesus came to give us that promise, that peace that nothing else can give us, that with eternal life, this isn't the end. It's just the beginning. As a matter of fact, some people would argue that the only reason that we are on this earth is to determine where we're going to spend eternity. Because the Bible says we're going to spend eternity somewhere. We're either going to spend it in a terrible burning hell where your body burns all day, all night, every day, but is not consumed. Worms eat your flesh. I think one of the most painful things is where the Bible talks, Jesus talks about another Lazarus, Lazarus and the rich man. The rich man is thrown, sent to hell. He begs for water, for someone just to touch a drip of water on his tongue, but that won't be done. But the most painful thing for him, he knows that his brothers are sinners and that they're coming to hell too. Hell is a real place of suffering. Now you turn on the TV, Hollywood, the world wants to mock and say that Satan isn't real and that God isn't real. But I'm here to tell you, testify, that I know with my heart that Jesus is alive and that Satan is real and he's working every day. And whether you're saved or lost, he is trying to work against you, to mislead you. But Satan doesn't have to have you, because God so loved us so much. John 3:16 said, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, Jesus, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." And then 3:17 says, "For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved." Because God loves us so much, he doesn't want us to be separated from God. Raise your hand if you've ever told a lie. All right. If you didn't raise your hand, you're lying right now. And you should be at church. You should be at this church at the altar Sunday. Amen. The truth is, everyone has lied. Every one of us has committed a sin. We're not sinners because we sin. We sin because we are born sinners. And one single sin separates us from a holy God. Because God loved us so much, as soon as Satan tricked Adam and Eve into sinning against God, he already had a plan of redemption. When he cursed Satan, when he cursed the serpent to crawl on his belly, he said, "There will be one come from Eve that will crush the head of that serpent." And that was his son, Jesus. He already had a plan of redemption for us, that if we would do what Romans 10:9 says, that if we would confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our hearts that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. James 4:14 says that life is a vapor. It appears for just a little while and it vanishes. If you've ever struck a match and that little puff of smoke that comes up and is gone just a twinkling of an eye, that is life on earth compared to eternity. Now, Brother Johnny was 81. He has one brother, Ronnie, that was 89. And how old are you, Brother Clayton?
86.
As far as the world goes, that is a long time. But as far as the things of God and eternity, that is a blink of an eye. You can be saved. You can be saved today. As a matter of fact, you could come talk to me or Brother Clayton today if you have realized, maybe at some point or with this message or Brother Clayton's message, that you realize that you are a sinner or in need of a Savior. You can be saved. But you don't have to talk to us. You can get on your knees wherever you are and say a simple prayer like this: "Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. Jesus, save me. I believe in my heart that you died, was buried, and rose again for my sin. And I turn from my sin. I repent, Lord. And I want to spend the rest of my life. You are my Lord." Amen. Simple as that. You can be saved. And that is what Brother Johnny did. That's good news, isn't it? He's in heaven. If you do the same thing, you can be in heaven also. As I said before, this is not the end, but it's the beginning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for the truth of your word. God, I pray for anybody in this room that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior. God, I pray, Lord, that you'd give them conviction, and that they would be saved. Lord, I pray for those, maybe they've been saved and hadn't been in church like they should. Maybe they hadn't been in prayer or in your word, Lord, and don't have that relationship that they need. Lord God, I pray that you'd work in their lives, that you'd convict them, and that they would draw close to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
tended it with care. Its buds began to blossom, their sweet fragrance filled the air. But when winter came, it withered, the petals drooped and fell to the ground. My heart sank as it faded, but I'd forgotten.
Notice that we have a lot of gnats out there. I want to ask you not to take none. If you live over around my sister, don't take none that way, because them, she's got to eat these. All right. Jehu. No, yeah. Maybe Floyd, Jehu, and Wilmer. Now, Johnny, Little Johnny, that's his name, Little Johnny. We're going to read a little bit here, and coming from Genesis, you can't miss it. The Bible says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth, and the earth was without form and void. Darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And God said, let there be light. And there was light. And God saw the light that it was good. And God divided the light from the darkness. Lord, help us, God, to do that that you'd have us to do, God. Forgive us when we fail in any way. Help us to say the things that would please you, God. And help us, Lord, ever, Lord, to stick to the word. In Jesus' sweet name, we pray for this family, God. And just embrace them, Lord, with thy Holy Ghost, God. Let them know, Father, you hadn't forgot them. You're right there with them. And the Holy Spirit will comfort them. I wished I could, Lord, but I can't. But God, he can. Now, the Bible says that everything, and if you don't believe this, you might as well throw the rest of the Bible away. Because from Genesis to Revelation, this is the Word of God. I accept it without a doubt. I don't accept the books it's wrote from when it left here, going somewhere else and saying this to somebody, because the only God I can tell you to worship is the Lord thy God, Almighty God, and his Son, Jesus Christ. And you can't get to the Father without you accept the Son, Jesus Christ. And Jesus, as he's being lifted up, prayed the Father that he would send the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, that he'd be in you and I. When old Clayton gets some bad memories about mine that he knows he don't need to do, don't get into something, the Holy Ghost says, Clayton, you repent. I said, Lord, forgive me in the name of Jesus. I didn't want to think that. It's the blackboard's wiped off again. You remember going to school and the teacher put stuff up there, we wrecked it. She might give you the ration, let you mark it off today and me tomorrow, whatever. But I thank God that salvation has appeared to every man, woman, boy, and girl. Nobody can stand before God and say, Lord, I didn't know. They will, though. They'll say, Lord, didn't we talk out demons in your name? Didn't we do great miracles? And he'll say, depart from me, I never knew you, you that work iniquity. We all know what iniquity is, sin. And the Bible also tells you and I, it's not just little things. You know, or big things that keeps us out of heaven. You know, there ain't no need to line every one of us to sin, come short of the glory of God until you accepted Jesus Christ. That's what you was. But if you've been born again, old things have passed away. Behold, all things are new. It used to didn't bother me to sin. Bless God, I could do it. Man, I enjoyed rambling around all night, maybe finding a girl to ride with me, whatever. Go in just in time, wouldn't be slept Danny but an hour or two before Mama shaves the clay and get at me breakfast. We're going to be here in a little bit. I said, I ain't going to do this no more. I ain't going to stay out all night. And I didn't until the sun went down, honey. But you know, I found a sweet little girl and all that went out the other way. And I weighed about 135 pounds before she got through with me. Look at me. Getting the right amount of sleep, amazing what it'll do for you. But you know, it was hard for me. I went for years running from the Lord. You say, I'm glad I ain't never run from him. Don't tell a story. When you feel that and you don't open the door and you refuse him, you slammed it in his face, you're running. But when it gets a strong directly, that you can't put it away no more. And you want to be saved. You done got older, you married, you got youngs. But you can't feel it. It ain't there. What you mean, preacher? I mean that you can send your day of salvation away. And you can go and you can want to be saved. Because I tell you what to say, bless God, that's not going to save you, friend. That conviction that leads you down and out, and you can be saved. I got as good a memory as in this church, saved in a truck. It don't matter where you're at. You can get saved if you meet the condition of God and God dealing with you. That's what he wants to do. save you for Christ's sake. Say, well, I'll be perfect. I won't have no problem. Buddy, you just started. First and come to me and said, look at that old big man crying. Don't you know there ain't nothing you want? And I believed it for a little bit there. But then they something about 4 inches below the collarbone began to tug and say, oh, preacher, I heard the gospel. I accept the gospel, old devil. I've been saved by the grace of God. And his old song says, I come in a fight, but oh, how happy I got that night. Looked down there by me, I thought, get a little, why she'd been saved. And she wasn't. She accepted Jesus the same time I did. You know, it's not when or where or how. A lot of people think, boy, if I could have heard Earl Roberts, if I could have heard Billy, it make no difference about who you hear. What did Jesus or the Father tell the rich man when he was wanting to go back and just testify to his brother? Said that if Lazarus goes by, he'll surely they'll listen to him. He said, if they won't have Moses and the prophets, neither will they hear one though he rose from the dead. So friend, that little thing you hold in the back, when I see so and so, when I get in his service, I'm going to get saved. You can drop that, honey. Today could be the day of your salvation. Tomorrow might be too late. So get aboard. You know, there wasn't a whole bunch you got on the ark, was it? You'd have thought there'd have been enough God out there to sunk it. But there wasn't. You know, I used to think, Darwin, and I still kind of feel this way, that when this old boy passes, get them guitars out, gentlemen, banjos, whatever you got, bless God, and begin to play. I love music. Somebody say, ain't gonna be no music in heaven. What you gonna do? Run David off? There's gonna be music in heaven. Don't let nobody fool you. In Revelation, there'll be people getting saved. But it's gonna be harder for them than it is you and I today. When the Holy Spirit's lifted up, Sister Judy, them cars will begin to run over the meter to get that person over there because they don't like the way he looks. It's gonna be chaos. I have here preachers saying, well, we won't be there. I sure hope they're right. I surely hope they're right. Not going to worry your patience a lot. Thank God, Johnny got in. Don't matter if you get in at the 11th hour, friend, get in there. Yeah. I believe I was saved in the 11th hour. Been preaching the gospel over 50 years, but still, I believe that on that Wednesday night was it. Either way I would go or I wouldn't, because I promised God. I said, Lord, if you would just please give me one opportunity. Let me feel it again. I went down to that aisle. I don't know if I went under them old pews or under them or in the aisle, wherever I went. But thank God for salvation. Now let's talk a little bit about little Johnny. I'm going to tell you what. I would to God, Ronnie, we'd have had a video of him when he was coming up. Woo, Lordy, what's that boy with something else? It was cold where we lived and froze one night. Now, I'm not telling you no story. This goldfish was, they'd be in the house in water, but it was cold enough, froze. But that's all right. He lived through that. Little Johnny gets him with mama's scissors and cuts off part of his tail. Would you believe he lived through that? Ronnie got a horse from my brother Wilmer, Tennessee Walker. Johnny took, I don't know how he cut the hairs off the horse's tail. But he did. I won't tell you what Ronnie asked Mama about the horse. Wait till we get excited with it, you don't know. But anyway, he may whip me again. But Johnny, he was full of life, I'm telling you what. And later on in life, as we growed up more, I went to work at Coca-Cola. And daddy-in-law thought I was working too hard outside. He didn't know how kind of hours he's fixing to shoot me into there. But anyway, I got Johnny in, James Huey on. Well, Johnny, he got smart, went to the trailer factory. Me and James Huey, we stayed at the Coca-Cola plant. And James Huey got a break, and he went there. You know, if you work at certain places, you can't take a day off because you can't afford to. You got to have something waiting when you leave, or you'll be in trouble. You lose that job, and then you'll be out of business. Man, are we making big money. $40 a week, honey. When that 15 cent come up on the dollar, they called us in the office. So, boys, never will forget, we don't have to give you all that. We decided to give you all that 15 more cent on the dollar. And we know better than that. We know it wasn't about the richest man in Waco weren't fixed to give 15 cent on the dollar without he had to. But anyway, James Ewing, Johnny was going, so got me lined up over here, and I went to the trailer factory. Johnny, he's promoting all the time. Johnny, what are we going to do? They ain't got nobody to sew the curtains. I could sew them. That boy ain't never sewed a machine in his life, but he done it. Made the curtains, and anything come up, I can do it. That's the way him and Jehu was. You ask me, Wimmer, or Floyd, I don't know about Ronnie. Ronnie's pretty good. He drove pursuit cars and everything else. But us three, all we knew was labor. But Johnny promoted himself. People liked him, too. So I'm sure that some didn't. They people don't like me. You wouldn't think about that, would you? But they are. They said, I don't like the way that boy looks. He looks mean. But what do women like? That's what I like. My girls didn't hear that. But I loved the little feller when he was little and loved him after he got grown. And I think about the times that me and him and Ronnie and James Hugh had down at the river. Remember one night, was running hooks. I don't know, James Huey didn't happen to be with us that night. And I took cats off to that thumb there. You ever took cats off, Bobby, till your thumb was just pure rough? We done it that night. We paddling, going another. About that time, a jack about that long come in that aluminum boot. And all three of us, just about everything but went out. We finally decided what it was and pinned him down. But, we had a lot of good times, and you know, when you're a little younger, everything seems so much better. But with Johnny, it's all over with, and I doubt me and Ronnie could run 2-4. Other words, our steps is getting closer. You ever see a man, he drags his feet everywhere you go? I'm just about to get every rug there, I'll pick it up. Like, I don't want to, but I do. Here comes the girls, I'm a walking stick. Here comes Donna Gill to check me, see what I dropped on myself. Regina, she'll quote me on something. But anyway, I wouldn't take $1 million for never one of them. Thank God for him. Thank God for Johnny's family. How he stood by him, he has stood by him, but how they've stood by him. And his in-laws, them Wilsons, I tell you what, they're a bunch of them people. You're about as many as you are Davises. And what I like about them, all of them's good. Amen? Wake up. That's good. All right. I understand we're going to open the casket and view the body for the last time. And I appreciate you kind of patient. Love all y'all. Praise God. I love it. Not even one in here I don't love. You say, oh, you don't love me? I do. I may not love what you do, but I love your soul, friend. And I desire to see you born by the Spirit of God. May the Lord ever bless you. And remember what Jesus said. It's expedient that I go away, because if I go not away, the Comforter won't come. But if I go away, I'll pray the Father, and he'll come and he'll be in you. And remember that. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. Oh, but preacher, my Bible says rooms. Well, baby, get you another one. In mine, it says mansion. I'm not worried about a mansion, but I'm just telling you like Jesus told him. He said, in my Father's house are many mansions. Well, I would have told you. And he said, I'm going away to prepare a place for you. And if I go away, I'll come again and receive you. That where I am, there you may be also. You ought to be shouting. God's people ought to be the happiest people in the world. We ought not to go to Sunday school or church looking like that. We ought to be smiling, showing our dentures. Enjoying our salvation, not enduring it, but enjoying it. Come on, Rodney. No, we got another song. I'm sorry. They have a time on me. I might say before the song start, we got professional undertaking.
Just